Orion presents Darkness Falls by Alex Knight, read by Jennifer Woodward. Part 1. Thessaly. Chapter 1. Thursday, February 4th. Rain, beating down like it had always been raining and always would be. The windshield wipers struggle to keep up, even on their fastest setting. The reflections of the lane markers and the taillights of the truck ahead would become clear for the briefest instant before being submerged again in a thick sheet of water, melting into blurry, untrustworthy hints of themselves, shifted an inch this way or that, becoming unreal. Thessaly risked taking her hand from the wheel for a second to rub her eyelids, one at a time. She didn't dare risk letting the road out of her sight for a second. Impossibly, the downpour seemed to step up a pitch, and she saw the brake lights of the truck flash as the driver slowed down, facing the same visibility challenge. Thessaly braked a little harder than necessary, saw the needle drop to 30, and then gradually eased the pedal down again to match the removal truck's 45 miles an hour. Rolling movers, the livery on the rear door had read, back when visibility had been good enough to make it out. Some family's earthly possessions making their slow way across America through the night. It was attractive. The thought of a blank slate, starting again somewhere completely new. But for the moment, she had no choice but to head back home. She wished she could have stayed over in Reading, but she couldn't cancel the editorial meeting tomorrow morning. It had been a straight choice between going and driving back after the post-service get-together, or missing the funeral entirely. It had sounded like a good compromise a couple of days before, but the weather meant a 3-hour drive was looking like extending to 4 or 5 hours if the periodically readjusting ETA on her GPS was anything to go by. Barely halfway home, and she was already tired. So tired. The day had taken more out of her than she had expected. Still, she was glad she had made the trip. Nate had been one of the best friends she had made in her time on the magazine. He had always been so much more full of life than any of the others. Always the first at the bar, always the first to suggest a beer on a Friday. If any of Nate's contemporaries had been asked to bet on his eventual cause of death, and Thessaly thought Nate would have enthusiastically approved of such a poor taste suggestion, it would have been liver failure or alcohol poisoning. Suicide? She thought that would be the last thing anyone considered. Nate had always seemed so together. Like a lot of her former colleagues, she had lost touch with him after Inside New York had finally shut down in 2017. The sign for an exit flashed by. She had a momentary panic as she read Greenville, because that would have put her a couple hundred miles west of where she thought she was, but then she realized the sign had said Grenville, only one E. Also derived from Green Village, she supposed, or perhaps just named after some long-dead British guy. The removal truck was crawling now, down to 35. If the rain didn't let up, she wouldn't make it back in time for the meeting in the morning. At this rate, she would get there sometime in late July. A third light source suddenly appeared in the darkness. Up ahead, and on the right-hand side, a red glow beyond the taillights of the truck. The wipers swept the wash aside for another moment, and she could see that it was a sign. A big red circle with some words beneath. It blurred again before she could read it. A second of clarity, she saw that the circle was an O, and below it the word Olympia, and some smaller words beneath, which might have been all night. Blur. A third sweep would take her past the sign. On the spur of the moment, she slowed and signaled, getting ready to take the turn when she could see it properly. She pulled into the almost empty parking lot as the wipers cleared and the rest of the sign revealed itself. Olympia Diner, all night, food, coffee, liquor. At least two of those sounded like a very good idea. There were only two other vehicles in the lot, a silver sedan and a black BMW SUV. Thessaly parked beside the BMW. She watched the road as the taillights of the removal truck slowly retreated from view. Her wipers were still on. Blur, clear. Blur, clear. Eventually, the twin red points of light vanished. Perhaps the rain would stop while she took a break. It didn't seem likely, but her eyes needed a rest. She turned off the wipers in the engine and steeled herself for the run to the door of the diner. She was drenched in the 10 seconds it took her to get there. She opened the door and stepped out of the February night chill and into the warmth, blinking in the bright light of the interior. A sign by the entrance said, "Please wait here to be seated," so she did. She wiped the rainwater from her forehead and looked around. It was an old-fashioned diner, but not old-fashioned in the fashionable sense. It wasn't a Disney reproduction of some kind of 1950s ideal, with checkerboard floor tiles or chrome fittings or red leather upholstery. But all the basics were there. A stainless steel lunch counter down one side, booths arranged along the opposite wall, a mix of fake vintage and humorous signs on the walls, "If my music is too loud, you're too old," an old Coca-Cola ad with two ladies in Victorian-looking bathing suits. She could smell coffee and hot oil. There was only one other customer in the place, a middle-aged bald man in a worn gray suit looking down at a notebook, a cleared plate to one side. He glanced up at Thessaly as she entered, his eyes squinting behind his glasses, then looked back down again. She thought that he looked tired, and not just because of the lateness of the hour. Salesman, she decided. Was traveling salesman still a profession? Or another thing the internet had killed, like magazines? She thought about Nate again, and the others. She had been luckier than most, snagging her first book deal right before the final round of redundancies. But perhaps the universe owed her that luck. A door behind the lunch counter opened, and a waitress stepped out. She was young, with brown freckles and dark hair tied back in a ponytail with a yellow ribbon. She didn't greet Thessaly with a hello or a "how can I help you," just raised her eyebrows expectantly. "Just for one," Thessaly said. Her name tag said Kayla. Kayla turned her gaze to the row of booths, thought about it for longer than seemed strictly necessary, and then gestured at the one closest to the bald man. Thessaly noticed that there was a plate on the opposite side of his table, the remains of somebody's meal on it, bacon offcuts, and an ignored pile of hash browns. She sat down with her back to the other booth. She ordered a black coffee when Kayla came around and glanced at the menu, quickly opting for French toast and bacon before she departed again. She shivered suddenly as a drop of icy rainwater dripped down the back of her neck. She ran her fingers through her hair to strain some of it out. Leaning forward, she put her face in her hands, massaging her eyelids with her fingers. The urge to doze off was powerful. She didn't fight it too much. Better here than behind the wheel, still well over 100 miles to go. She breathed through her nose and listened to the sound of the rain beating rhythmically off the roof and then splashing into puddles at the side of the building. She listened to the hum of the coffee machine or the milkshake dispenser or whatever it was behind the lunch counter. Underneath that, she heard the muffled sounds of plates and skillets clattering and rattling in the kitchen.
"So, are we done here? I guess I should tell you good luck."
She started and opened her eyes before she realized the man in the next booth wasn't addressing her. She felt a bump through the back of her seat as someone sat down behind her and adjusted their position. She blinked the tiredness out of her eyes and saw that the coffee she had ordered had already appeared. She must have been closer to sleep than she thought. And then she heard something that made her wonder if she would ever sleep again. the voice of the person sitting opposite the bald man.
You ever hear that old saying, waiting for luck is like waiting for death?
Thessaly felt an icy chill travel the length of her spine that was nothing to do with rainwater. She knew that voice better than she knew her own mother's. She had been hearing it in her dreams for half a lifetime. The voice of the man in the booth behind her belonged to a man named Casper Sturgis, the man who had murdered her brother 20 years ago. Chapter 2.
Waiting for luck is like waiting for death.
Thessaly straightened up in the booth seat like somebody had yanked her strings. The words were as painfully familiar as the voice. Mitch's killer had told him it wasn't his lucky day. Then he had used those exact words before he pulled the trigger. She didn't turn around. She stared straight ahead at the vintage Coke poster on the far wall. It felt like she wasn't in the diner anymore. It was 20 years ago, and she was still in the Redlands Mall. She had never left Deadlands. The guy who looked like a salesman was talking quietly. She couldn't make out individual words over the thump of her pulse in her head. And then she heard the voice again, cold and deep, so deep that if she heard it on a song, she would assume the producer had looped in some kind of effect, like the voice of a bad dream, like the feeling of a partly healed wound being scratched at with ragged fingernails. She felt her head begin to swim, and the two Victorian ladies on the Coke poster looked like they were moving. She gripped the edge of the table and closed her eyes.
"You okay there?"
Kayla, the waitress, was examining her with a mildly concerned expression. She was carrying Thessaly's order in her right hand. Her left was poised for action, as though she expected Thessaly to topple onto the floor at any moment.
"Fine,"
she mouthed, but no sound came out. She cleared her throat.
"Maybe a glass of water?"
Kayla nodded, and then looked up as one of the men in the other booth caught her eye. Had to be the bald man. The killer was facing the other direction.
"You fellas okay?"
"Just the check when you got a minute, thank you."
Thessaly reached for her phone. It was lying face down on the table. When she turned it over and looked down at the screen, she was almost surprised to see the slender black mirror of a Samsung Galaxy and not the chunky gray Nokia 3310 she had thought was pretty nifty back in 2001. She risked glancing around. She could only see the back of his head, dark blonde hair with some gray, the collar of a plaid shirt. Beyond where they were sitting, on the far wall of the diner, there was a neon arrow pointing toward the restrooms around the corner. She gripped the edge of the table and slid out. Her legs were unsteady as she moved quickly past the two men. She passed a mirror sign advertising Budweiser, and her reflection told her why the waitress had seemed so concerned. She looked as though she was auditioning for a vampire movie. When she had made it three booths down, she risked stopping and turning around. The two men were continuing their conversation, neither looking up. She couldn't see the man on the other side of the table at first. The salesman's head got in the way. But then he shifted position to take his wallet out, and she had a clear line of sight. Dark blonde hair, a dusting of stubble that had pinpricks of gray, a little fuller around the face and the chest than he had been 20 years ago. He was wearing a white t-shirt under a plaid shirt. He noticed Thessaly staring and glanced in her direction. She looked down quickly, pretending to examine her phone screen. When she stole another glance, he had looked away again and was talking to his companion. Him. It was him. She went around the corner and stood outside the restrooms, relieved to be out of the line of sight of the man in the seat, but not wanting to take her eyes off him. How long did she have? They had already asked for the check, and the waitress didn't have anything else to delay her other than Thessaly's glass of water. She tapped the three numbers on her phone and held it to her ear.
911 emergency, which service do you...
Police, putting you through.
The line wasn't great, weather making the sound glitchy. She glanced around the corner and saw that the waitress had left the check on the table the two men were sitting at. The salesman was leaving cash.
Pennsylvania State Police, are you reporting an emergency?
Yes, I mean, I think so.
What is the nature of your emergency, ma'am?
I think I saw a murderer. I mean, I know I did. He's here now. His name is...
You're reporting a murder.
No, a murderer. The person who committed a murder.
Ma'am, are you in danger at this moment? Where are you?
No, he doesn't know I'm here. His name is Casper Sturgis. He killed my brother and I just saw him.
Somebody's hurt?
She gripped the phone tighter and tried to speak slowly without raising her voice.
No, he killed my brother 20 years ago.
20 years ago?
I think he's leaving. You need to send someone now.
There was a long pause, and Thessaly wondered if the dispatcher was going to admonish her for wasting police time. Too late, she realized she shouldn't have been specific. Send a cop, any reason. She could explain when they got here.
What's your location?
Can't you tell from my phone? I'm at some diner on the 78.
The location I'm getting is no good. Looks like you're somewhere in Northampton County, but I can't see specifically.
Her mind went blank for a second.
What the hell was this place called again? Something about sports. No, the Olympics. Olympia. I'm at the Olympia Diner on the 78 eastbound. Please hurry.
She looked out again and saw that the two men were already leaving.
Sit tight, ma'am. We'll have somebody with you in about 15 minutes.
Thessaly hung up and looked around the corner. The booth was empty, the door at the exit slowly swinging shut. By the time the cops got there, they would both be long gone. She made the decision in a second and headed for the door. If she could get a license plate, she would have something to give them. She hurried outside and saw that she was too late. The silver sedan at the far side of the lot had started up, its headlights bright in her eyes. It started moving out and turned right onto the highway. She saw the red light of the diner's sign reflect off the driver's glasses for a split second. The salesman. The BMW followed it out, turning in the opposite direction, crossing over to the westbound side. Thessaly ran for her own car. She had left her jacket in the booth inside, and she was soaked to the skin by the time she got into the driver's seat. She pulled out of the space and accelerated out of the lot, sending a shower of muddy rainwater over the windshield as she bumped in and out of a big pothole at the exit. She turned into the westbound lane and pushed the pedal down as far as she dared. The needle climbed above 70 before she was rewarded with the sight of taillights ahead of her. She switched the wipers to full and risked going a little faster, feeling the wind buffet her as the rain poured down like she was in a car wash. She was gaining. Soon, she would be close enough to read the BMW's license plate. And then the other car seemed to widen the gap a little. Did he know he was being followed? Had he noticed her coming out of the diner right after he did? She gritted her teeth and pressed the pedal all the way to the floor. The needle jumped over 80 and kept rising. This was insane. She never drove this fast on a cloudless summer's day in the middle of nowhere. She was closing the gap, though. The other car slowing a little as the road began to climb. Almost there. She could make out the contrast between the white plate and the blue numbers now. Another 2 seconds and... A truck appeared over the crest of the hill in the opposite lane, full brights on. She braked and squinted as she tried to keep her car in the lane. The truck dimmed his lights and blew past her with a thunder of 18 wheels. She opened her eyes fully again, but it was too late. The other car had disappeared over the crest of the hill, and the needle had dropped to 40. She floored it again, the transmission taking its time to shift and the engine complaining as she tried to accelerate uphill. She crested the hill, wondering how much the gap would have widened, and saw nothing.
just blackness ahead. The strip down the center of the road, the only feature she could make out. The other car had vanished. The highway curved around, and she hoped it would straighten out and she would see a set of taillights, but there was nothing. She passed a sign. Grenville, 1/4 mile. He had to have taken the turn for Grenville. There was no place else to go. The GPS map showed a straight road ahead. The exit was the only one for miles. She slowed and took the exit. Chapter 3. Thessaly pulled into the parking lot of the Olympia Diner 30 minutes later. She took a sharp breath when she saw the gray patrol car parked in the very same space she had occupied earlier. In all of the excitement of trying to follow Sturgis, she had completely forgotten she had called the police. Granville had been a dark maze of buildings with unlit windows. It felt like it had no center. If the BMW really had taken that turn, it could have been anywhere. The car could have been any of the dozens parked in the driveways that she drove past. Challenging in daylight, impossible at night during a rainstorm. There was nothing to do but go back and retrieve her jacket. She parked next to the patrol car and steeled herself again for the run to the door. When she made it inside, soaked to the skin once again and shaking, the waitress from earlier looked up at the doorway and pointed an accusing finger at her. "That's her, officer." There were 2 uniformed state troopers at the lunch counter, both men, cups of coffee in front of them. Raindrops beaded on the waterproof canvas of their jackets. One was older, late 50s, gray-white hair and a mustache. The other had blonde hair and green eyes and looked ridiculously young to be in any kind of position of authority. What was it they said about the policeman looking younger? "Hi," Thessaly said, giving an apologetic smile. "You came."
"You're the one who made the 911 call, ma'am?" the older of the 2 men asked.
"That's right. My name is Thessaly Hanlon."
"I'm Trooper Fetterman, and this is Trooper Reed," he said.
Fetterman had hooded eyes that made him look like he was on the point of dropping off.
"Says here you got..."
He stopped to consult a notebook in front of him, rather unnecessarily.
"A murder. Is that correct?"
He finished by taking a moment to look around the surroundings, remarkable as they were only for the lack of murder. "It was a bad line. I saw someone. The man who killed my brother Mitch years ago." Fetterman glanced briefly at his partner and the waitress, then back at Thessaly.
"You saw him in here?"
"Yes. She saw him too." Fetterman looked at Kayla expectantly.
"There were 2 guys here when she came in. I guess she's talking about them?"
"One of them, yes. Casper Sturgis, the blonde man with the plaid shirt."
Fetterman looked at Thessaly, then Kayla. Kayla shrugged. "I don't know what you want. Yeah, there was a guy in a plaid shirt and a guy in a suit. They ordered coffee, pancakes, paid cash. We don't require names and ID."
"Do you have any security cameras?" Fetterman asked.
"Covering the register, not the seats."
"Thank you."
Fetterman's gaze switched from Kayla to Thessaly. He indicated the stool next to him.
"Have a seat, Miss Hanlon."
When she sat down, he scratched her name in his notebook and then put the pen down to massage his temple.
"Let's backtrack a little. Your brother was killed."
"Murdered, yes."
"I'm sorry for your loss. When did this happen?"
20 years ago, in New Jersey."
"In Jersey?" Reed interjected, as though Thessaly had said the surface of Mars rather than the next state. Fetterman held up a hand to silence his partner and shifted around on the stool so he was facing Thessaly, subtly distancing Reed and Kayla from their conversation.
"And this man..."
"Sturgis."
"Sturgis murdered him."
"Yes. I saw it happen. I was a witness."
"When did he get out?"
It took Thessaly a moment to work out what he was asking.
"What? No, he didn't get out. He didn't go in. They never caught him.
Fetterman raised his eyebrows and took another sip of his coffee. He turned to Reed for a second. Thessaly couldn't see his expression, but she expected it conveyed the sentiment, "This is gonna be a long night." He turned back to her. "The local police investigated your brother's murder?"
"Yes, McKinley Hills PD. The detective who was primary on the case was Mick Hendricks. If you speak to him, he'll confirm everything."
Fetterman held a hand up.
"I didn't suggest you were making this up, ma'am."
She opened her mouth to say that maybe he hadn't out loud, and then decided this approach wouldn't get her anywhere she wanted to go. She bit her tongue and took a deep breath.
"We were exploring. We went to see a dead mall."
"A dead mall?"
he repeated, saying each word carefully, as though neither was familiar.
"Yeah, you know, they call it urban exploring these days. A closed-down mall, an abandoned place out in McKinley Hills, the Redlands Mall. Me and my brother Mitch and our friend Lee. It was supposed to be deserted. We interrupted some kind of drug deal or something. They never worked out exactly what it was. I was hiding. I saw a man shoot my brother, my friend Lee, and the guy he was there to meet. The police got there, but Mitch was dead. Lee survived. I told them everything, gave them a description of the man, the car he was driving, everything."
"They find him?"
She shook her head. "No sign of him. It was a good description. I had a lot of time to look at him, to listen to his voice. I'm never going to forget him. They were looking for the vehicle right away. They never found it. Somehow he just disappeared."
As she said that, she remembered hearing the sound of the engine fading to nothing as she knelt over her brother's body, fruitlessly searching for a pulse. From that moment, he had been gone. They both had, Sturgis and Mitch. She cleared her throat and tried to marshal the important details.
"They took Lee to the hospital and Mitch to the morgue. They drove me to the police station. These days, I guess they'd have a counselor or something, but I'm glad they didn't. They just got straight into questioning me. They did a great job. Well, Hendricks did, anyway. He wanted to know everything. Why we were there, how we got in, if we knew the two men. I think at first he thought we were mixed up in it. They got a sketch artist. They showed me mug shots. Nothing."
"What about the other man who was killed?"
Fetterman asked. He was interested now. Maybe he had accepted she wasn't making this stuff up. She nodded.
"They moved on to him next. They identified him pretty easily. ID in his wallet. He was a used car dealer named John Ammerman. His wife had no idea he was there. He had told her he was in Sacramento for a conference that day. They looked into his finances and found he had a lot of gambling debt, like 200 grand.
"I'm assuming he was mixed up with some criminal elements."
"It seemed so. They found irregularities in his business's accounts going back years. It hadn't been picked up on by the IRS, but once they knew there might be something there to look for, they found it. He had been laundering large sums of cash for a long time. Hendricks told me if they could work out who Ammerman was working for, it might lead them to the shooter."
"And since you have a name, I'm assuming that's what happened," Fetterman said. "Mob guy?"
"No, not anybody they knew about locally anyway. They looked into that at first. The man I had seen wasn't on their radar. Detective Hendricks cast the net wider. I went through more mug shots, and we found him."
"A guy who looked like the shooter?"
She shook her head firmly.
"No, not a guy who looked like him. It was him. Casper Sturgis."
She could see the scene in her mind like it was 5 minutes ago. The cold interview room with the scarred wood table. The 6-color photographs laid out like playing cards. She remembered it had been the eyes that convinced her. That didn't make sense, of course. Back in the Redlands Mall, she had never been close enough to see his eyes. But when Detective Hendricks had flipped over the page in the book, the eyes had told her this was the one. Blue and empty, like the eyes of an intelligent animal. Wily, but without a soul. And then, Widening her focus, the rest of the features had matched up perfectly. Dirty blonde hair, the distinctive jawline. She had asked who he was after repeating 3 times that she was certain this was the man who had killed her brother.
Hendrik said they would bring him in, but they didn't. He disappeared, and I guess sooner or later they stopped looking for him, and that was the end of it.
As she said it, she knew that wasn't true. The truth was that it hadn't ended. In 20 years, she had thought about her brother and about the man who had taken him from her every single day. There was no ending to the story. Trooper Fetterman asked a few more questions and promised to make some inquiries and to check out the register footage. She knew that would likely be futile, remembering Sturgis's friend leaving cash at the table. Before the 2 state troopers left, Fetterman suggested that Thessaly stop at a motel rather than continuing to drive through the storm. He even recommended one, 10 miles along the road. Thessaly assured him she would think about it and thanked him.
"We'll be in touch if we get a lead on this gentleman," he told her as he left the Olympia.
She liked to think he meant it, but she wasn't holding her breath.
Chapter 4. It was after 6 a.m. by the time Thessaly made it to Buchanan and home. She collapsed into bed for a couple of hours' sleep and then dragged herself back out to shower and dress, leaving herself just enough time to drive to the train station. The meeting was in the city, at the offices of her publisher in Midtown, or, to be more accurate, her client's publisher. Her first novel had been picked up in a 2-book deal for a pretty good advance, but the book hadn't sold, and the follow-up had done even worse, and so there had been no great clamor for a 3rd or 4th book. After sending a few pitches around to no avail, her agent, Evan, had landed her a ghost job writing a memoir for a television actress, just to tide her over. That one had sold surprisingly well, leading to more ghost work. She was writing 2 a year now, and pretending to be other people was bringing in more money in a year than she would have made in 3 at her Inside New York salary. She told herself she would try writing another novel of her own sometime soon. Sometime soon was always vaguely defined, but always after this. The current project was fiction. She had signed a deal with Greystone, an imprint of one of the Big 5, to ghostwrite a basketball-themed mystery novel for Megan Adams, the sports reporter. Despite the 2 hours' sleep and the events of the previous night, she had managed to stay fully attentive in the meeting. The news they had given her wasn't great. They wanted to move up publication to summer rather than fall, and would she be able to deliver in 2 weeks rather than at the end of April? She waited until they offered a bonus before telling them she could do it. She could do it, couldn't she? Riding down to street level in the elevator, the meeting and the daunting new deadline evaporated from her mind, replaced with the more immediate memories of the previous night, or, to be exact, the early morning. Would the state police really look for Sturgis, or had Trooper Fetterman merely been humoring her the way his partner clearly was? She decided it probably didn't matter either way. They had nothing to go on. Kayla, the waitress, had never seen either of the 2 men sitting in the booth behind Thessaly's before last night. They had paid cash, so there would be no credit card trail. Thessaly hadn't gotten a license plate, despite her best efforts. All she had was that Sturgis had been driving a black BMW SUV. After looking it up on the BMW website, she decided it was likely an X7 model. She didn't even know for sure that the car had taken the Grenville exit. It would have been easy for her to misjudge distance in the dark. Perhaps Sturgis had just gotten so far ahead that its lights had been lost in the rain. And if he had turned off for Grenville, it didn't mean he had stopped there. Nothing to go on. A chance encounter with the person who had taken her brother from her and sent her life on a different track, and she had blown it. Now that the meeting was out of the way, thinking about the missed opportunity made her feel tired and empty and diminished somehow. It was as though someone had stripped away every good thing she had managed to achieve against the odds over the last 20 years. She caught the 414 on the Hudson line from Grand Central, taking a window seat and gratefully resting her head against the glass. She fell into a dreamless sleep somewhere after Harlem. When she heard the voice of the announcer say, "Next stop," she started awake so abruptly that she elbowed the man in the suit sitting next to her. She mumbled an apology as he frowned and looked back down at his book.
"What stop?" she asked.
The man in the suit didn't look up.
"Ossining."
She sighed with relief and settled back into her seat. Another two stops still to go. She looked out of the window as the marina rolled by and then the buildings dropped away and the Hudson glinted in the winter sun. It made her think about summer sun about 20 years ago. The trip to the Redlands Mall had been Thessaly's idea, and so when you came down to it, it had all been Thessaly's fault. Post-graduation, she, her brother Mitch, and his friend Lee had decided to go on a road trip to see Queens of the Stone Age play at the convention hall in Asbury Park, staying in a dive motel overnight, driving back home in the morning. It was Thessaly's first time at a concert, and she had loved it. The lost art of keeping a secret was the highlight of the show. They had all drunk too much. There was a moment when Mitch had gone to the bar. The band started playing In the Fade. Thessaly put her hand on Lee's arm and then left it there. They looked at each other, and she knew they were going to kiss, and she could see in his eyes that he knew it too. They were leaning in when she saw Mitch out of the corner of her eye. Lee followed her gaze and flinched back, so obvious. Mitch had come back to borrow Lee's lighter and knew exactly what he had interrupted. None of them said anything, but she and Lee kept each other at arm's length the rest of the evening. The unspoken tension in the car the next morning was the reason she had been looking for a way to break up the return trip. Mitch was quieter than usual when he wasn't making more than usually cutting jibes at Lee. Thessaly knew he wasn't going to be pleased with his best friend making a move on his twin sister. She thought it was the main reason nothing had happened between them over that long summer. She hadn't really wanted to dwell too long on her feelings for Lee, and up until that moment during In the Fade, she had no idea he reciprocated them. Not that it would have been a good idea, even ignoring her brother's thoughts on the matter. She had been accepted into Princeton in the fall. Lee and all her other hometown preoccupations would be in the rearview mirror soon. The detour to the Redlands Mall seemed like a good distraction, a way to break up what would otherwise have been a long, uncomfortable drive. Kevin Moritz, one of the harmless malingerers in the drama club, had told her and Mitch about it one day as they smoked out back behind the workshop, or at least he and Mitch were smoking. Thessaly had never started, a virtue of which she was quietly proud every time Mom made a meaningful comment about smelling smoke whenever Mitch walked into the room. "It's sick, completely deserted. It's like fucking Dawn of the Dead. You gotta check it out." It had sounded fun. She talked them into it. Mitch protested, said he just wanted to get back home. She could tell Lee was intrigued, but he pointedly stayed out of the discussion. Eventually, Mitch relented and detoured on the 280. The mall was a couple of miles outside the nearest town, the surface of the empty parking lot rutted and peppered with weeds. It already looked post-apocalyptic, even though the mall had been closed less than a year. Somebody had spray-painted the word Deadlands in red paint across one of the shutters over the main entrance. They found the busted open fire door at the back of one of the units, a shoe store, going by the signage and the ankle-level mirrors. Thessaly couldn't remember much of what they had seen after that, just disconnected snapshots in her mind's eye, shafts of sunlight stabbing down through a dirty glass ceiling, spearing dust particles in the main atrium, a nest of rats in a hole in the drywall in a sporting goods store, a sign shaped like a giant key dangling from a single length of chain, swaying in a faint breeze from somewhere else in the mall. And then the muffled sound of a car engine outside, followed by the ratchet of a parking brake, followed by the piercing rattle of a roller shutter being thrown up. She remembered everything after that. The train pulled to a stop at Buchanan. She gathered her coat and bag and navigated the way out, headed for the parking lot. Chapter 5. It was a little after 5, but already getting dark when Thessaly parked her burgundy Subaru Legacy in the driveway of her home, a detached split-level house on a quiet street in Buchanan, New York. Sometimes when she parked, she paused for a moment and looked up at the house to think, "I didn't do so badly." She had made the down payment on the house with the advance on the second ghost deal with Greystone, when she and Josh had been thinking about kids and maybe a dog. The relationship didn't continue long enough for either. After the breakup, her friends were surprised that she stayed in the house. The place had 3 spacious bedrooms plus a master on the 3rd level. It had an eat-in kitchen. It had what the brochure called cathedral ceilings. It had a huge yard opening onto woodland. Surely it was too big for one person. It was. That was one of the reasons she liked it. But today, she had just one thing in mind, and a moment of grateful reflection wasn't it. She unlocked the door and tapped her fob against the alarm to deactivate it, then stepped inside, kicked off her shoes, and called out to Alexa to turn on all the lights. After a pause, every room in the house lit up. Josh had been a gadget nerd, had made sure they had all the mod cons. She had been skeptical at first, but had gotten used to the convenience. Using her phone to turn the heating on from 30 miles away meant she wasn't returning to a freezing house, for instance. And though she never admitted it to Josh, it made her feel secure being able to turn all of the lights on at once when she was alone in the house. A good thing, too, now that she was always alone in the house. She walked through to the kitchen. The coral pink February sunset was lighting up the clouds above the treetops, casting a fiery glow through the double-height windows above the patio doors. She turned on the bean-to-cup coffee machine in the kitchen. That was her type of gadget, and went upstairs to the small bedroom she used as a study to turn on the computer while the coffee machine did its thing. The study was her favorite room in the house. It had floor-to-ceiling bookshelves on 3 walls, a rug over the varnished floorboards, a green leather Chesterfield couch where she could curl up and read. Her desk was set up at the window, overlooking the street outside. The sky was fully dark on this side of the house already. The lights were all on in the Page house across the street. The kids were bouncing on the bed in the front bedroom. As she watched, the door opened and Lucy Page appeared, pointing her finger and remonstrating soundlessly with her daughters. They slunk off the bed and left the room, heads bowed. Thessaly smiled and tapped her mouse to wake the screen. As it came to life, it lit up the framed photograph next to the monitor. The photograph had been there so long that she barely saw it anymore, but tonight she let her eyes linger on it. It had been taken in May of 2001 at an oyster bar in New Haven, Mom's birthday. In the picture were Thessaly, her mom and dad, and Mitch, all huddled around the 2 small restaurant table. It wasn't a particularly good picture. Dad had red eye from the flash, and Mitch had a spot of Tabasco on the sleeve of his shirt. But they were all smiling, and it was the last picture of them all together. There had been other photographs between then and now. Thessaly and her mom and dad, and then just with her mom. And then there had been no more at all. None of the pictures that followed had the same easy smiles, the same carefree look in the eyes. Within 5.5 years of that unremarkable family dinner, 3 out of the 4 of them were gone. She would give anything to be able to talk to any one of them right now. Taking a deep breath, She shifted her gaze from the photograph to the screen. She saw that she had forgotten to close the Word file of the Megan Adams book when she had finished work before leaving for the funeral. That could have been a pain in the ass, had she managed to do any work between then and now. It would have meant having to resolve different versions of the document. But in this case, zero productivity had paid dividends. She saved and closed the file and opened up a browser window. Work would have to wait a little longer. Casper Sturgis had never been very far from her mind all these 20 years. This wouldn't be the first time she tried to find him on the internet. It wouldn't be the 100th time. She had more than a dozen Google alerts set up listing various search items. She would receive an email if a new web page appeared that might be relevant. Thankfully, it was an unusual enough name not to throw up many false positives. She had other alerts set up for when her brother's name appeared on unsolved murder websites. That had happened a lot in the first decade, but had died away to nothing now. The last hit had been a brief mention of the murders in an article on Dead Malls of America, maybe 5 or 6 years ago. There were many more lurid unsolved murders to be picked over and theorized about than Mitch's. The trail wasn't so much cold as completely overtaken by the jungle. There was no trail, not anymore. But now, for the first time, she knew the man who had killed her brother was still alive, and she knew that he had been eating in the Olympia Diner on I-78 at 2 o'clock that morning. And she knew that he was with another man who drove a silver car. She understood it wasn't much to go on, as the pitying expression Trooper Fetterman had worn throughout their interview suggested, but it wasn't nothing. It was more than she had had for 20 years. Thessaly Googled the diner first. It had a rudimentary website, proudly stating that the Olympia had been open since 1947. There wasn't much to the site, a few interior pictures and a downloadable menu. She looked up the town next. Grenville had a population of 26,000. The Wikipedia page took up less than the height of the screen. Its most notable former residents were a minor league baseball coach and an actress who had been a recurring guest star on General Hospital. The Google map showed an orderly grid of streets fanning out for a couple of miles on either side of the main road through town. Two rivers split the town before intersecting. The street layout north of the intersection point looked older, more organic. Pins identified places of interest like the bus station and the library and the Baptist church and the 7-Eleven. She switched to satellite view and spent a minute or two scrolling over the roofs of family homes in wide yards. She heard a low buzzing noise from elsewhere in the house, and it took her a second to remember she had left her phone by the coffee machine. She hurried back down to the kitchen and picked it up. Private number. She answered with a wary hello. There was a long pause and then,
"Is that Ms. Teresa Hanlon?"
"Thessaly," she corrected, guessing that the speaker was attempting to decipher a handwritten note.
"Thessaly, okay."
There was a pause and somehow she could tell the speaker was writing her name down more clearly.
"This is Detective Tyler, McKinley Hills Police Department."
Her pulse quickened. She hadn't expected a callback this quickly. "Yes?"
"You called for Detective Hendricks?"
"That's right. He was the primary on the investigation into my brother's murder. He used to call pretty regularly to let me know what he was looking into, but I guess it's been a while and..."
"I'm afraid I have some bad news. Detective Hendricks passed 2 years ago."
Thessaly took a deep breath. "Oh, I'm sorry." The man on the other end didn't respond, and she wondered if she was supposed to say anything else. She hadn't heard from Hendricks in a while, but it hadn't even crossed her mind to think anything had happened to him. "Was he sick or?"
"Accidental firearms discharge."
"Oh, I'm very sorry to hear that." She knew enough to know what that meant. a last favor from the officers called to the scene to a brother in arms. A lot of cops die that way every year. Always accidental, never suicide.
Yeah. Anyways, is there something we can help you with?
She sighed. There had been one person in the world she knew for certain would be sympathetic to her story, who would back her up. Now she found that person hadn't been in the world for 2 years. She went through the story anyway. A roadside diner in the middle of the night. A chance encounter. A missed opportunity. To his credit, Detective Tyler listened and sounded like he was writing some of it down. He asked a couple of questions. He mentioned that the Redlands Mall shootings were before his time, but that he knew of the case.
I'll tell you what. I'll see if I can talk to someone over there. See if they know anyone matching this description. I gotta be honest with you, Thessaly.
I know. It's a long shot.
Long shot's putting it mildly. But there's one good thing. A leopard doesn't change his spots. If this guy is still on the scene, chances are the local cops have him on their radar.
Thessaly felt herself choking up a little and didn't know quite why. Sadness for Detective Hendricks, perhaps. A good man, perhaps worn down by too many unresolved cases like hers. Gratitude that one of his co-workers was taking her seriously, perhaps. She cleared her throat and thanked Detective Tyler. After she had hung up, she looked down at the phone in her hand for a long time. She had been putting the call off, making a whole list of things she had to check and find out before she did it, but she couldn't put it off any longer. If the situation was reversed, she would want to know. The number wasn't saved in her phone. The number had been lost in the ether 7 or 8 upgrades ago, and she hadn't replaced it in her list of saved contacts, even though she could have done so at any time. She couldn't begin to guess at any of her friends' phone numbers, or even the number of her local Chinese takeout place, which, embarrassingly, was probably the single number she called most often. Now, there were perhaps a half dozen numbers she could remember off the top of her head, and none of them were in regular use. The landline of her childhood home, her brother's cell number, Dan, the guy she dated for the first 2 years in college, and Lee. She had changed her own number at least twice since 2001. There was a very good chance Lee would have done too. She would probably have to make more of an effort if she really wanted to get a hold of him. Most likely, the number would have been dead for years or reassigned. She thought they did that when a number had been dormant long enough. So what harm could it do? She opened the keypad, the action unfamiliar as opposed to scrolling back through recent calls. She dialed the number, and her thumb hovered over the call button. She made herself tap it. A pause, and then it rang. Not disconnected then. 2 rings, 3, 4. Suddenly, her heart was in her mouth, and she wasn't sure why. Please don't pick up. Please be.
The ring cut out, and she took a sharp intake of breath as she heard a voice. But then she realized it was just the voicemail. The default recording for the cell network. No hint of who the number belonged to now. Straight and to the point. Please leave your message after the tone. The tone sounded, hurrying her into saying something.
Hi, it's Thessaly Hanlon. I just wanted to...
To what? She hadn't thought this through at all. She canceled the call. Relief. The strange anxiety subsided. She put the phone in her pocket and went back upstairs to the study. Grenville in its entirety taking up the center of the monitor screen. She ran a finger along the vertical line of the road, along the path the black SUV would have traveled the other night.
Chapter 6. Friday, February 5th. Thessaly had a lot of time to plan out her day on the drive back down to Grenville the next day. Being honest with herself, she didn't think she had a very high chance of finding the man she was looking for, but maybe that didn't matter. Maybe going and looking was enough in itself. If she took what little information she had and explored every possibility leading off from that, then at least she could satisfy herself that she had done all she could. She wouldn't find herself lying awake at 3 a.m. in a year's time, knowing it was definitely too late to do anything about it now. Drake, her editor at Greystone, probably wouldn't be too happy if he knew she was spending her day driving to Pennsylvania when she was supposed to be chained to her computer finishing the book. But that was one of the advantages of her job. She could do it, or not, from anywhere. The 287 wasn't too busy headed south, the traffic getting a little thicker as she joined the 78. The heaviest traffic this stretch would see would be early morning and early evening. Commuters yawning behind the wheel as they covered the monotonous miles between the office and the twin parking garage in their affordable commuter town. She took her eyes off the road and reached across to the passenger seat where her tablet was lying dormant. She tapped the screen to wake it, glancing down the keep list she had made for the day ahead. The first item was the easiest, and thanks to a phone call before leaving, she was just in time to cross it off. Kayla's shift started at noon, and it was just gone 11:30. She pulled into the parking lot outside the Olympia 10 minutes later and took the same spot she had used the other night. The big pothole at the entrance was still half full of rainwater, though the local weather said the area had been dry for the last 24 hours. Thessaly had accumulated a lot of useless information like that about Grenville and its environs over the last couple of days. Take the Olympia itself. Opened in 1947, like the website said. In that time, it had had only two owners. The current owner was one Joseph P. Haim. Daylight didn't improve the look of the Olympia. In the rain, she hadn't paused to take in the details of the exterior. Now she could see that it was a long building with white wood siding that looked like it had last been painted when Clinton was president. Wide, railroad car-style windows extended from either side of the entrance, which jutted out as an enclosed porch. A thin streak of bird shit bisected the top curve of the unlit neon O above the sign. Inside, Thessaly was greeted at the wait-to-be-seated sign by a heavy-set red-headed guy in his 20s. He wore a white short-sleeved shirt with no name tag and had blue shadows under his eyes. He tried to seat her by the window, but she asked for a specific booth, the one Sturgis and the other man had occupied the other night. She could kill two birds with one stone by eating lunch while she waited for Kayla to get in.
Welcome to the Olympia. I'm Hal. I'll be your waiter today. Get you something to drink while you look at the menu?
Yes, please. I'll have coffee.
She smiled in a way that she hoped conveyed she was a good tipper.
And I was wondering if I could ask if you've seen somebody I'm looking for?
Hal blinked, looked around the diner, and then back to her, a confused look on his face.
Like a customer, she clarified. He might have been in recently.
She took a sheet protector containing all of the hard copies she had printed last night from her bag and slid the one with the blow-up of Sturgis's face out of it. It was based on the original sketch that had been done from her description in 2001. The McKinley Hills PD had software that allowed them to digitally age facial composites the relevant time from when they were originally logged. Thessaly didn't know how accurate the software claimed to be, but from her sample size of one, it was a dead ringer for the man she had seen the other night.
"You a cop or something?" Hal asked, looking unsure.
I'm just really interested in finding him, Thessaly said, before leaning forward with a sheepish look on her face. It's a genealogy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.